Hello, I'm Ethelbert Miller. Welcome to The Scholars. Dave Zirin is a sports editor for The Nation and the author of several books on the politics of sports. His most recent book is Jim Brown, Last Man Standing. How you doing, Dave?
Hey, great to be here. Thanks for having me. Great to be back at UDC.
Oh, great.
Where I got my teacher certification many years
this
ago.
This is homecoming.
Yes, and where we protested in front of the school to keep it open. Mm-hmm. Did civil disobedience right on Van Ness and Connecticut Avenue, so haven't been back in a while. So
well,
nice.
I'm glad that you could find some time for us.
Absolutely.
You know, you opened this book by talking about how, actually quoting Jim Brown saying, I came up at the crossroads of segregation. What did you mean by that?
Well, I mean, the man was born in 1936, so if you think about his early years, I mean, he's 18 years old when Brown versus Board of Education takes place. He's 19 at the time of the Montgomery bus boycott. So, I mean, one of the things that Jim Brown said to me is that he knew about that there was a civil rights movement, and he knew that there was such a thing as race and racism for as long as he was conscious. Although I think his actual history is a little bit more complicated than that. He actually lived the first 8 years of his life on St. Simon's Island off the coast of Georgia.
The Gullah Islands.
And for folks who are unfamiliar with what that area may have looked like in 1936 through the early 1940s, I mean, you're talking about an area that was a very independent African-American marshland.
Right.
And because it was areas that plantation slave masters, slave owners, they felt like they couldn't quite tame the environment there. Mm-hmm. And so the people who were enslaved who lived there were largely left alone. So they were less acculturated by Western European slavocracy, which meant that after the Civil War, for example, you had scholars go down there to learn about Western Africa because many of the traditions actually survived to St. Simon's Island. And that's the environment where Jim Brown grew up in, and I think it had an effect on him throughout his entire life because he was never a believer in the integrationist aims of the civil rights movement. He believed very strongly in what he would term black self-sufficiency. Mm-hmm. And the idea of, instead of fighting for integration, building up an independent economic base, which was always the conservative end of the black freedom struggle. And I think all of that was shaped very profoundly by growing up in St. Simon's. And then at age 8, he is moved to live with his mother in an all-white community, almost entirely all-white in Manhasset, Long Island.
Right.
Almost all-white, but also a very liberal community. So one of the things that he has said and that he said to me is that he did not know about racism and that kind of hatred, that he didn't know it existed because he grew up around a lot of love among the white community there.
Now, I'm listening where you outline his life in, you know, the Seacoast Islands and now Long Island. But you also say in the beginning of your book that right now the history of Jim Brown has a new currency. What does that mean?
Oh, I think it has a new currency for several reasons. I mean, first of all, how we understand the black athlete in 2018. I think many of us look at someone like LeBron James, who takes a very strong role in how his team, the Cleveland Cavaliers, how they are run. And he's almost a mogul and a part owner and a business partner in addition to just being a player or just being an athlete. And Jim Brown, I think, is the template for that. Really years, if not decades, before other players took that up. I mean, Jim Brown was really responsible for organizing his own locker room so players could make their own statements. And this was before there was even a workable union in the NFL.
Right.
And so players could make their own statements and their own demands on management. And in addition, he played a role in getting his legendary coach, Paul Brown, fired from the team. And that was something that was really unheard of at the time. So that gives his story currency today. I think what else gives it currency is that Jim Brown is an active supporter of Donald Trump. And I think for a lot of folks, like my broadcast partner, Atan Thomas, who played in the NBA and believes very strongly in the concept of the activist athlete, I mean, that was a heartbreaker for Atan. But one of the things I try to argue in the book is that you can understand that journey to supporting Donald Trump if you understand his politics over the course of 50, 60 years. And another reason why I think his story has currency today is that we live in the era of the Me Too and the Time's Up movements, where we are, as a country, looking at the issue of violence against women in a much more critical light.
Before we get to that, you know, you have this book, Jim Brown, Last Man Standing. And throughout the book, you talk about manhood.
And masculinity.
In the beginning of the book, you talk about him being a Superman. Mm-hmm. And when I read that, I said, okay, if he's a Superman, what weakness does he have in terms of kryptonite? And later in the book, mm-hmm. you mentioned the thing about women.
His relationships with women.
So talk about him being a Superman and then the whole thing about the kryptonite and the women.
Sure. I mean, the part about Jim Brown being Superman, that was nothing that I came up with. Mm-hmm. That's something I found in the black press and doing my archival research about how Jim Brown was understood at during his time. And it's amazing how much of the black press reached for the Superman metaphor, and how many other players reached for Superman metaphor and said things like Superman and black skin. And I always thought Superman was very interesting in terms of how Jim Brown was discussed, because the entire Superman mythos at its origin mm-hmm. is an assimilationist story about achieving your respect in America as a Jew. That's what the story is really about. Superman was created by Schuster and Siegel, two Jewish writers. And Clark Kent is very much like a Jewish stereotype. Very a bookish, awkward
glasses.
Right. And then Superman is Mr. All America, and this exists and beats in his heart. Mm-hmm. And I think for Jim Brown, that's always been what we could describe, or what Mike Freeman, another sports writer, described as his fierce patriotism, this idea of I'm going to fight for my place in this country. And so I thought it was interesting that a lot of black sports writers in the black press, which is just absolutely invaluable when it comes to archival research, referred to him in many different forms as Superman. And that's part of it. And then you mentioned the kryptonite, and that Jim Brown, it's not so much women being his kryptonite as his relationships with women, because that puts it on women as if somehow they're at fault. And Jim Brown has a very documented history of accusations of violence against women that stretch across over three decades. And it's a very ugly history, but I think the way to understand it is by understanding it as the toxic side of this ideal of masculinity. And this is where masculinity becomes an important part in understanding Jim Brown, because in the black community, masculinity is often used as a sword and a shield against white supremacy. I mean, think about the Memphis 68 sanitation worker strike, where Dr. King lost his life, and the slogan was, "I am a man." And or when Malcolm X was assassinated, and Ossie Davis's famous immortal eulogy, he said, "Malcolm was our manhood." And so this assertion of masculinity becomes a tool against racism or white supremacy. But one of the things I argue is that masculinity as constructed in this country, which spans black, white, the ideals of it, that there's an ugly undercurrent to it.
Yeah, when you say that, and you mentioned the acknowledgement, it took many years for you to write this book. When I get to some of the chapters near the end, I see you coming into the text more.
Trying to see
in terms of like wrestling with these issues, because you're looking at footage of, you know, Ray Rice and others. How difficult was it for you to write, you know, these chapters, especially when you look at Jim Brown as a hero?
Well, it's very difficult. I mean, Howard Bryant, who reviewed the book, he's a writer for ESPN, he said Jim Brown is heroic and no hero. And by the time I was done writing the book, I was thinking about that old phrase from the 70s that a hero ain't nothing but a sandwich. And if I could, may I read just the opening? I started the book with a quote from Ken Burns, the great documentarian.
Right.
And one of the things that Ken Burns said, which to me was like the guiding lotus star in the entire book, is he said, "We always lament in the superficial media culture that there are no heroes, but that presupposes that a hero is perfect. And what the Greeks have told us for millennia is that a hero isn't perfect. Heroism is the negotiation between a person's strengths and weaknesses. And sometimes it's not a negotiation, it's a war."
Mm-hmm. You also take that and you can make reference to Martin Luther King.
Oh, certainly. Except I think, though, that that none of our heroes are perfect. But I think the issue of violence against women, which has never been ascribed, certainly, to Dr. King, I mean, it is something that's particularly pernicious. And I don't think that Dr. King, from anything I've read, had that same, let's call them hang-ups, mm-hmm. about masculinity and what it means to be a man. I mean, Jim Brown, those first 8 years of his life in St. Simon's Island, his nickname as a boy was Man, mm-hmm. and he was the only man in his family. His father had run out. He was not being raised by his mother at that early 8 year period. His mother was up in Long Island and she sent for him at age 8. But those first 8 years, he's being raised by his grandmother, his great grandmother, his aunt. And I do think that that's when this idea of the need to be a man,
right.
and all the baggage that comes along with that, you know, like you don't show weakness, you don't show pain, you don't show vulnerability. And then you think about that compared to, and put that up against the fact that Jim Brown never missed a game when he played in the National Football League.
Or run out of bounds.
Or run out of bounds. I think it's all connected.
Mm-hmm. You know, this book, it's not just about Jim Brown. It seems like it's also about the city of Cleveland. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering about, you know, looking at the period when he retires around 66, what's happening in Cleveland, you know, politically in terms of the economy?
We
have the coming in of Carl Stokes in 67.
Yeah, to me, Jim Brown's career arc in Cleveland represents, in so many respects, Cleveland before the fall, if you will. Mm-hmm. When Jim Brown starts playing in Cleveland in the mid-1950s, the city is a thriving part of the industrial belt. It's one of the largest cities in the United States. It's kind of like Chicago Junior. Mm-hmm. And it was so industrialized, so much a part of the car economy in the United States, also very connected to Detroit, that there were whole neighborhoods in Cleveland where there would just be soot in the air. Mm-hmm. And while that sounds like an environmental catastrophe
right.
to us, back then it was almost a point of pride that you could walk through a neighborhood and workers, industry, Cleveland, a city
prosperity.
On the grow.
Right.
And that definitely covered up the ways in which black Cleveland had access to inferior jobs, inferior places within the unions in Cleveland. Mm-hmm. But it was still seen as this city on the grow, this industrial hub. And by the time Jim Brown is leaving Cleveland, it's starting to be referred to as, or maybe this happened a little bit after, but it's being called the mistake by the lake.
Mm-hmm.
And deindustrialization, the process has started.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, racial conflict has exploded out into the open because of instances of police brutality. And the Hough riots become something that's on the lips of people around the United States. And so it's a very different kind of community. And then Jim Brown leaves Cleveland to make his fortune in Hollywood. Mm. And I think for a lot of folks that I talked to, that was a very symbolic moment because Jim Brown was Cleveland,
mm-hmm.
and then Jim Brown leaves Cleveland.
Mm.
And a generation of people then followed him and left Cleveland. And Cleveland has lost, you know, 50% of its population in the last mm-hmm. generation. People tell me it's on a
right.
little bit of a comeback now.
Sure,
I don't want to be sound like I'm slamming Cleveland.
Right.
But that idea of him representing Cleveland before the fall, and I gotta compare this to sports because when Jim Brown comes to Cleveland, it's also known as the city of champions. And he, of course, wins an NFL championship, a pre-Super Bowl championship in 1964. And then another title does not come to Cleveland again
until
LeBron in 2016. So the symbolic weight of we're not a city on the grow. We're not a city where there's soot in our fingers.
Mm-hmm.
We're a city of high unemployment, of deindustrialization, and a city that can't win any sports championships. All of that stuff was intimately connected.
Mm-hmm. You have in your book a very important meeting that took place on February 25th, 1964 in Miami with Jim Brown, Muhammad Ali, Sam Cooke, and Malcolm X. Talk
mm-hmm.
about that meeting.
We'll talk about manhood and black masculinity. I mean, the sheer wattage of those four
wattage,
names.
Right, yeah.
This happened right after then known as Cassius Clay. Cassius Marcellus Clay Jr. defeats Sonny Liston in a huge upset in Miami. And after the fight, there was a big plan for a party at the famous Fountain Blue Hotel. But instead, at Cassius Clay's request, he wanted to just eat some vanilla ice cream and sit in the Hampton House Hotel, which was known as a black hotel on the dark side of town, as they put it, where black celebrities would often stay. And he wanted to have a meeting with those folks, Malcolm X, Jim Brown, and Sam Cooke. Now, within a year of this meeting, Sam Cooke and Malcolm X would both be dead.
Mm-hmm.
And for decades before his own passing in 2016, Muhammad Ali had really lost the ability to speak and communicate because of Parkinson's disease. Right. So Jim Brown's really the last witness from that meeting. And I was able to speak to Jim Brown about what actually went down in this at this famous meeting. And I found it to be a fascinating remembrance by him, because this is literally like the day before it becomes public that Cassius Clay was going to join the Nation of Islam, and he would be known as Cassius X or Cassius X Clay. And then it was just soon after that that Elijah Muhammad, the leader of the Nation of Islam, the supreme leader, the prophet, the messenger, would give Cassius Clay the name Muhammad Ali. And one of the reasons he gave him the name Muhammad Ali was because he was in a power struggle with Malcolm X. Malcolm X, at this time, was suspended from the Nation of Islam. And there was a real battle for who would be, control is the wrong word, but who would be the ally of Muhammad Ali. Would Muhammad Ali go with Malcolm, who was his friend, or would he go with Elijah Muhammad, the messenger? Right. And one of the things that Jim Brown told me about what was happening in that hotel room was that, you know, that there was a kind of awkwardness there, because on the one hand, they were all talking about what Cassius Clay's future would be, the ups and downs, the pitfalls of joining the nation, the risks that it would entail, how he wanted to chart being a world champion going forward. But at the same time, there was this tension, because Malcolm was trying to get some answers from Cassius.
Well, you know, what I found interesting in your book, which I didn't know, you mentioned how the Nation of Islam was against Ali protesting, the draft and being inducted, that they would want him to go into the service.
Well, they were concerned about the attention, particularly the attention of COINTELPRO, the FBI, surveillance on the Nation of Islam. And they saw, not only are there things in Nation doctrine that had them opposed to prize fighting, seeing it as entertainment for...
But they also saw it as a money-making venture, too.
Yes. They liked the money-making
right,
part,
right.
The Nation. They did not like the prize fighting part, in theory. So it's a huge mix of ideas coming from the Nation at this time. At one point, when a lot of people don't know this, when Muhammad Ali said that he wanted to get back in the ring and fight again, when he was suspended from fighting because of his refusal to enter the draft, there was an editorial in the newspaper Muhammad Speaks where Elijah Muhammad even said that he was taking the name back from Muhammad Ali, and would no longer be known as Muhammad Ali. And Muhammad Ali then, you know, apologized for his statements, because he said he wanted to get back into the ring and make some money. It was just one of those offhand comments that he made. And the irony of all this, of course, is that the Nation of Islam, Elijah Muhammad, his son, I believe it was his son Herbert, they all spent time in jail for...
Elijah Muhammad spent time as
Elijah Muhammad certainly did, as a conscientious objector. And that's the path that Muhammad Ali wanted to follow.
You know, talk about the Black Economic Union between 1965 and 1972 that Jim Brown was behind.
Well, Jim Brown said to me he thought that this was the most creative and important contribution of the Black freedom struggle, if he did say so himself. And it reflects the conservative edge of the Black Power movement, because there was a part of the Black Power movement that was not about the Black Panthers, that was not about revolution, that was not about trying to organize and fight for resources. There was a part of it that was about building your economic base without any quote-unquote handouts. And that's where Jim Brown was politically. And so he, and to his credit, he attempted to act on those beliefs, not just try to make money for himself.
It seems to echo what you said earlier about him supporting Trump.
Yeah, it is connected. And it's why he also supported Nixon in 1968. People forget, and this is part of the history I tried to revive here, is that the first Black Power convention ever held in this country was held by a Black Republican named
Nathan Wright. I think it was funded by Clairol.
Yes. And Richard Nixon made a speech where he spoke about liking Black Power, where he used the phrase Black Power.
And I think that's when Black Power is Green Power or something like that.
Yeah, Jim Brown said he didn't believe in Black Power, believed in Green Power. And he wasn't talking about environmentalism. He was talking about making that money. And Green Power was where, and that's a quote that Jim Brown has said over the course of 60 years of his life, of that green power is the only power that matters in this country. And he saw the black economic unions as a way to facilitate that green power. And the effect of them was very strong. I mean, they sent a ton of people to business school, young black students to business school. They were able to provide seed money for businesses.
But you know, I'm curious about, when you say that, if I was a young athlete and I'm around Jim Brown and I'm making this money, it seemed that that would still resonate today. If I looked up to him, he would be telling me, okay, this is what you should be doing.
Yeah, the problem with that is that it also puts him in opposition to the idea of protest. So Jim Brown said just a couple of weeks before we're doing this interview right here that if he was the general manager of a team, he wouldn't sign Colin Kaepernick. And we talked about his support of Donald Trump. And he also went into the locker room of the Cleveland Browns to tell them to cut it out when they protested and took a knee before the anthem at the beginning of last year. Now, these are things that, I mean, to me, are a betrayal of today's generation of activist athlete. And a lot of folks saw it as a betrayal. And he was asked that question about, like, well, how can you say that when you were an organizing athlete back then? How can you be against athletes organizing now? And his response would be a very measured response of saying, well, we were for organizing to make money and build our economic base. We weren't trying to organize against, you know, racism, police brutality, and all the rest of it, because that gets, you know, you off track from the kinds of things that he thinks we can organize around. Now, I would say to him, and I would say to you in the audience here, that if you divorce the struggle for, you know, economic justice from the struggle for racial justice, you're going to lose every time, because racism and structural racism are a reality in this country, and you can't get economic justice without fighting for racial justice. But that's where,
you know,
we differ.
Near the end of this book, you quote Jim Brown in terms of saying, I found this interesting, you never dance.
Yeah. And
what did he mean by that?
Well, he was I asked him for his own definition of manhood. And what he meant by that was, I think, it's funny, I can only divine what he meant by that. And what I believe he meant by that was, you have to see yourself as a quote-unquote man. And to dance is to be like almost a step and fetch it character. It's to be a clown. It's to be there solely for the entertainment of a largely white audience. And you have to be more than an entertainer. You have to be somebody who sees yourself as a business partner, whether it's in the venture of sports or in your life. And, you know, that's that manhood coming through. You know, this idea that being a man is about self-sufficiency and not showing emotion and being able to support your family and all these things. And that's, you know, never dance. Yet there's another side of it to me, which, you know, puts a little tear in my eye, because I think of the Emma Goldman quote about, you can have your revolution if I can't dance. And or I think about, you know, the Norman Mailer book called Tough Guys Don't Dance. And, you know, I think about Satchel Paige, who said, you know, dance is like as if no one is watching. I mean, dance is a beautiful thing.
Would it,
and to deny himself dance is sad.
Were there any people that you wanted to interview about Jim Brown who said, okay, Dave, I don't want to talk about
him. Sure. There's only been, I won't name names, but the list, that list was very long. And I one of the reasons why I wanted to write this book is that there's only been one other biography ever written about Jim Brown, and that was astounding to me. People can go to their computers and look up how many biographies have been written about Muhammad Ali, and the list is long as your arm. But for Jim Brown, only one other book ever written about him. And I think some of that is that people are closed-mouthed about the subject. I think there's an element of fear about just how taking on this idea of how complicated his life is. And, you know, I was excited and intellectually invigorated by the challenge of trying to understand this person who I really do think contains multitudes, as we say.
Is he a mythical figure in terms of certain things that just aren't true, but we just want to believe they're true?
There's certainly stories about him, stuff that I couldn't publish, stuff that I probably won't discuss on the show, because he's almost, I describe him in the book as almost a Paul Bunyan-esque figure. Like, because, you know, he comes from a time not only before selfies and before we have this young generation now, I'm sounding old, but this young generation now that records their every move and records their every step, for the purposes of the entertainment of themselves and their friends, I think unknowingly creating a rather remarkable archive of the times in which we live. It also speaks back to a time where the games themselves were filmed, often in black and white, and not all the games were even filmed.
Right.
So when people talk about Jim Brown on the playing field, and certainly when they talk about some of the partying that went on in the Hollywood of the 1970s, of which he was a part, you don't get stories so much as you get myths. Mm.
You know, I know that when we talk about athletes, the person you hold in high regard is Muhammad Ali.
Definitely.
When I look at Muhammad Ali, I look at him as a spiritual person, especially the transformation. What about the spirit of Jim Brown?
Not a believer in the spirit, you know, not a church person in the same kind of way. I mean, he's somebody who, you know, whether you're talking about his work with gangs or whether you're talking about his work inside or outside the prisons, I mean, he's somebody who operated very much on a grassroots level, about as grassroots as it gets, and his head was never in the church. His growing up, those first 8 years at St. Simon's Island, there was an effort to get him involved in what was the new evangelical churches that coincidentally were popping up in St. Simon's Island just at the same time they were putting down fence laws and trying to clear out the marshlands for luxury resorts. Interestingly, that happened exactly at the same time. That's when the evangelical church went into St. Simon's, but that was just something that was never for
okay,
him.
Okay, well then he's the last man standing. Dave, I want to thank you for joining me on The Scholars. Thank you for watching. I'm Ethelbert Miller.